Good morning, everybody. It seems we're all struggling to get used to the 11 o'clock start. But hey, it's lovely to welcome you here and all those people who've managed to get up on and find us online for 11 o'clock, not 11:30. Sorry if you're tuning in at 11:30 and you've missed the first half, but you know, you can rewind, that's okay. what's today?
It's the 14th Sunday after Trinity, but it is also the second Sunday of our frontline Sundays, where we're thinking about God using us where we are. And in a moment we're going to watch a video to that effect. But let's begin with just a moment of quiet and of prayer as we come and meet with God this morning. So Lord Jesus, we thank you that you meet with us wherever we are. And Lord, as we come this morning with all the thoughts and emotions, the hopes and the sadnesses, all the things that have been going on in our lives this week, Lord, we lift them to you. And we ask, Lord, that you would be with us this during this time together, that we'd encourage one another, that we'd hear from your word, but most of all, that your Holy Spirit would meet with us, filling us and equipping us and molding us and shaping us. Guide us, we pray. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
So, just before our opening song, we're going to watch the second of these videos. You'll see that each video features the same, I think it's five or six people. Each week we're going to sort of focus on them. This week we're thinking about God being with us wherever we are. Thanks, Steve.
Hours a day,
6 days a week,
whenever I'm needed,
every Saturday morning.
I spend my time
in a place that matters to God,
with people that matter to God.
My front line,
in the stresses,
successes,
problem solving,
tantrum resolving,
laughter,
teamwork,
jokes,
tears,
boredom,
tension,
cups of coffee,
cans of Coke.
God is working with me.
He helps me see what he sees.
Put here by God.
He knows the day ahead.
This place is rich with possibilities.
This is my front line.
Come back to those words a bit later on. Just a reminder of what we're thinking about. As we thought about last week, there are perhaps not that many of us who would call ourselves Christians who would go to church on a Sunday. About 6% of the population goes to church at least once a month. But when we go out into the world, God can and does use us to influence those around us. Next slide, please. And so as we do that, God invites us, wherever we are, whatever we do, to see the world through his eyes. So we're going to begin our service this morning with a song which speaks exactly of that. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord, that we would see God in each other, in this place, and in the world around us. Shall we stand and let's worship God together? Do please take a seat. As we come and as we recognise God is in our midst, so we recognise that at times we get it wrong. And so we come to God confessing our failures and our faults. Those times when we've done or said the things that we know we ought not to have done. Those times when we've not done or said the things we know we should. Those times when we've stood by whilst others have suffered. We pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour. In thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, we are truly sorry and repent of all our sins for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. May Almighty God deliver us from the powers of darkness and restoring us the light and image of God. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So, for the second week in a row, I had intended to have a big map, but the map's still not here. postal deliveries, there we go. That today we're thinking about the places that we go. The places that we go every week, or maybe once a fortnight, but the places that are part of our lives. And we're thinking about what it is that God is calling us to do in those places. Over on the table over here, I've got some of these, and these are ostensibly for the children, but anyone is welcome to do it as well at some point. And I'm going to give these out a bit later when Lynn comes to talk to us. But what I've got here is a target, like an archery target. And what I invite us to think about and maybe draw or write are the places where we go on a weekly basis. And if you're feeling particularly creative, you could chop two or three of these up and stick different colours on the archery board so you can see the differentiation. But to think about those places close to home, where we spend most of our time, then those places where we go regularly, where we meet others. And then those places which maybe we don't go so often, but which are nonetheless important for one reason or another. Maybe it's a relative who lives a long way away, or somewhere that we hope not to go very often, but which we seem to spend more of our time than we'd like the hospital, for example. And invite us to think about how we can encounter God in all of those places. Thank you, Steve. We're going to sing again. And this is one which we used to sing when I was in school. But it talks about going out into the world and sharing the good news of Jesus with the people who we meet in the world around us. So let's stand and let's sing together. Please take a seat, and we're going to have our first Bible reading this morning. And Peter, you're going to come and do it. Lovely.
Our first reading is taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 28, reading from verse 10. Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. When he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth, with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. They were above it stood the Lord, and he said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham, and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go. And I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done it, what I have promised you." When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it." He was afraid and said, "How awesome is this place! There is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
As you're able, perhaps you'd like to stand, as this is a communion service. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Our reading starts at chapter 24, verse 28. And it's part of the end part of the story of the road to Emmaus. As they, Jesus and two disciples, approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread. He gave thanks and broke it and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem, where they found the 11 and those with them assembled together, saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Just before Lynn comes and shares with us, do sit down, Mother. I'm going to bring these over to the back table, and if anyone would like to come and grab one and some pens, and whilst Lynn's talking, think about those places that are close to home, those places that we go every week, and then those places where maybe we go less often, but which are still important as part of our life, and putting them on there. The verse I've got at the top is, "Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as though working for the Lord and not for human masters," from Colossians 3. I was thinking, as Peter was reading us that reading from Genesis earlier, about yesterday, girls, patience. Yesterday, we were going back to the car from something that we've been to, and there were three options for the journey. There was the staircase, there was the middle, which was half staircase, half ramp, and then there was the ramp round the outside. Trust me, the staircase felt very much like what I imagine that staircase that Jacob saw was like. Because it says that Jacob saw the angels descending and ascending the stairs. And I don't know how they did it, because I was knackered up halfway up the staircase, to be honest with you. So, but the point is, of course, that wherever we are and whatever we're doing, God is with us wherever we go. I'm going to hand over to you.
Thanks, Lewis. I think I'm switched. No, there we go. I'm going to stay here. Little question for you first before I begin. Can anybody remember the four people that were in the video at the beginning, what they were doing? Shout it out if you remember. Well, he was till the alarm clock went off. And then, when they were active, what jobs were they doing? What was their front line, the four of them? Say again?
A football trainer.
Thank you. Volunteer football trainer. granny, who was childminding, absolutely. Miss Melissa, you're on an advantage. You've seen it twice. Anybody remember the other two? Yeah, somebody in an office, wasn't she? Trying to deal with people. Yes. And what was the other guy working on a boiler? Or a sink or something? A plumber, that was his day job, wasn't it? Yeah. For very ordinary... Was there a bus driver in there as well? Did I miss the bus driver? Thank you very much. Thank you. Five people. A whole handful. So, okay. So very ordinary people, men, women, different ages, some volunteering, some in paid work, but each of them with a role to play. And those roles change from time to time in our lives, as the grandma there doing the childminding would acknowledge, I'm sure, because I do on a Tuesday childmind my grandson, and I know Steve does his as well on occasion. So it's, yeah, it's a delight, isn't it, Steve? Absolute delight, but tired at the end of it. Oh, boy. Anyway, pleased to hand them back. There we go. Okay. But our Bible stories this morning, we've got two stories. We've got Jacob, who chose a stone for his pillow. I can't imagine anything much more uncomfortable than that. But anyway, gave him a bad dream or a good dream, whichever way you look at it. But he dreamt of the stairway up to heaven, where heaven and earth meet. This must be the gateway to heaven, he said. A thin place, a touching place. I'm sure there's more than one gateway to heaven. And we know quite a lot about Jacob if we've read any of his story. He wasn't always kind or considerate or caring. In fact, he was a bit of a cheat and not a terribly nice person to be around some of the time. However, this is the point where he changed his way. And in the New Testament, we met two followers of Jesus, not the closest of disciples, but some of the others. And they were walking away from Jerusalem after the crucifixion, deflated and dejected by what they had seen and witnessed. And they're leaving town because they're pretty certain that the authorities will be coming after them fairly soon. And there they are, glumly walking along the road when a stranger comes and starts talking to them and opening the scriptures for them. And they hear Jesus' voice. Well, how does that apply to us? For me, I looked at both of those things and I saw a similarity. There were people there who were going in the wrong direction. They were going in the wrong direction. Literally, walking away from Jerusalem. Morally, Jacob. Behaviourally and emotionally. But God, in his love for both of them, went out to seek those who were lost and revealed himself to them. And at that point, their lives were changed beyond any recognition. Now, dreams and visions often appear in the Bible, because it's God's way of kind of kick-starting us into thinking about his message. And you can probably remember loads more than I can about what dreams and visions appeared. And the voice of God was always considered rather a terrifying thing. Moses had his fair share of voices from God. Sinai. But before that, the burning bush. I mean, you can look for it and it appears. And of course, at the baptism of Jesus, there was God's voice again. But that's not how it is for most of us. There's not this booming voice coming from heaven speaking to us. There's not this kind of mountaintop epiphany moment of magic turnaround. For most of us, it's just something that grows in our hearts. There's an inner understanding, a knowing, an assuredness, which comes from us trusting that God is there with us and will continue to be there with us through everything. Sometimes we need to gather together with others for the reassurance of our friends, other Christians, other family members, or sometimes we just witness the goodness of others, and that helps us to appreciate the goodness of God. When long time before I came into ministry, when I first started coming to this church, one of the questions I used to ask myself, and I still ask it today, is how do I know that this bright idea that I've got, or thought, or plan, is of God? How do I know that? What is it that gives me the clue to knowing that? And it takes me back to that old adage that I always used to throw at my husband. If in doubt about how to do something, read the instructions. Do that first before you unpack everything and lose the screws and the whatever else is. Okay. So what's God's instruction book? It's the scriptures, isn't it? So we go back to the manual. We read the scriptures. And if what I'm thinking of doesn't tie in with the scriptures, then I think again. And then I might get into a bit of a conversation with God. Now, a conversation tells you that's a two-way thing. It's not just me giving it all to God. It's actually about God coming back with some sort of answers. And Mother Teresa of Calcutta, when asked about the purpose of prayer, she said, she didn't say it was to get things off your chest and, you know, offload all your troubles and everything else with God. She said it was to listen to God's speaking. So in this world that we're in today, where everything's immediate and we need it right now or it's not quick enough, a bit like our maps coming by snail pace, snail mail, however they're coming, it's very frustrating when we don't get an answer straight away. But Mother Teresa's answer was, if you don't hear, keep listening. Give it some more time. Give it some more time. And then I don't know if you do sometimes what I do. You do get an answer, but you think, that can't be what he meant. That doesn't fit in with my way of life. That doesn't fit in with my thoughts and my plans. A real conversation with God is about putting down our humanness and holding on to God's plan, not our own. Sometimes very hard to do. So Jacob awoke from his restlessness, his uncomfortable night of his dream, and he declared, "The Lord was here and I didn't know it." And at Emmaus, the disciples declared, "Didn't our hearts burn within us as he revealed the scriptures to us? The Lord was here, but we didn't recognize him." How often do we fail to recognize the Lord's presence with us? I know I'm very good at complaining to God when things go wrong, or lifting him the bad things. I'm not very good at giving him the joys as well. Thanking him for all the good things that happen. But joys and concerns are all good to lift in prayer. In the situation that we're in right now, our front line that we're in right now, that might not be the same as the front line we were in a while back. My front line's changed radically over the last few years, which is a good thing. Keeps us fresh, keeps us thinking. Where do I need to be present today? Well, I need to be present in this place, not on my phone or checking out anything else. I need to be here, present with you, talking to you, thinking about what God means to me and what God means to each of you, and how we might share that with others. But there are always pressures, aren't there, on us, which tend to focus our attention on ourselves when we're short of time or short of energy or short of money. Our focus looks inward, but God is asking us to look maybe a little wider than that for those who need to know his love, who are maybe on the edge of our lives. It's difficult sometimes to think about how we might show God's love to those who don't know him, in our homes, in our workplace, on the bus, when we're moving around from one place to another, wherever we go for our front line. How can we express God's love? That depends on what the purpose God is, what purpose God has for us right now, at this stage of our lives. Now, there is a postcard which you can take as you go, as well as doing your targets. And it's got three words on it, three P's. Presence, pressure, purpose. Laris was talking about at the beginning. Where are you present? Where will you be this time tomorrow? Where will you be present then? What are the pressures on you about being in that space? What are the difficulties that might arise? And thirdly, what's your purpose there? Most of us will be doing something that we enjoy. It's funny that, isn't it? We tend to do things that we enjoy rather than things that we find tedious or hard. But what pressure is on us? Focus on the purpose. And then the very bottom line on the back of the card says, your prayer. What do you need from God to help you in the place where you find yourself? What do you need from God? We all have a front line, a point of contact. Sometimes we choose it, sometimes it's put upon us. But take a fresh look at it when you go home. Use this card to help you if you like. Talk to a friend about it, whatever works for you. And then pray. Seek God's grace to help you face that front line and have the courage to share God's way with others, because that is the way that our church will grow. Thank you.
Thank you, Lynn. We're going to pray now, and what I'd love for us to do, which is slightly different from what we normally do, but I hope you'll forgive me, is invite you to turn to someone next to you or near you and ask them what it is that you could pray for them for this week in particular. What is their front line? What is it you'll be doing this time tomorrow or maybe at some point this week? Because we are the body of Christ in this place. We are called to encourage one another. So we're going to begin our time of intercession just by praying for one another. So I hope that's all right. So just the person next to you or someone who's near you, just for 30 seconds or so, share something that's happening this week that you would like us to pray for, and then swap over the other person's share, and then pray for one another quickly about what it is. Is that all right? Go for it. folks, if you haven't started praying, can I encourage you to do that? Lord, for the things that we've shared and the things on our hearts, we ask that you would help us to listen to your voice speaking to us wherever we may be. Lord of all creation, thank you that our everyday, ordinary places matter to you, and we make a difference wherever we may be. We offer to you the places where we live, where we work, where we study, where we play. May we serve you and bear witness to you wherever we are this week. And may we know your presence with us in these places. Amen. And Lord, we just quickly lift to you all those who we know who are unwell this week. Those who we know need to know that presence with you, presence from you in their moments, in their lives this week. We thank you for your healing and for your hope. We praise you and thank you that John's been able to come home this week. We pray for him and for Angela. We pray, Lord, for your presence with each one in our congregation and each one known to us personally who needs to know that hope of your healing and your presence this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Can I invite you to stand and we're going to share the peace with one another. On that same evening, after he'd appeared to the disciples on the road, Jesus appeared amongst his followers in the locked upper room and said, "Peace be with you." And they were glad when they saw the Lord and knew his presence with them. May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I invite you to share with those around you a sign of God's peace. We are going to sing again, Steve, if you put the words up, very few of you, if any of you, will recognise these words, but I pretty much guarantee that you will recognise the tune. The tune is Eventide, or Abide With Me, these words were written especially for the Thy Kingdom Come prayer initiative as part of the Church of England's commitment to seeing God break through in every part of our society and asking God to be present on our front lines. So, as I say, hopefully you'll be able to sing along even if the words are unfamiliar. So let's sing together. We seek your kingdom. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you.
here.
His spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Do please be seated. And as we recognise God's presence with us in every part of our lives, so we recognise his presence with us now as we break bread together. As those first disciples found, they recognised Jesus as he broke the bread. So we too recognise the work of the Holy Spirit among us now. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but you came and you met us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, Jesus took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. In the same way, after supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you are with us, and that as we have asked, so we have received. We pray that as we listen to your still small voice this week, you may open our eyes to see afresh this world which you have made, that we may see your presence and know that you are always with us, wherever the journey may take us. Guide us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Just before our final song this morning, a few bits and bobs of notices. Next Sunday is Harvest Festival, so please do come along with some cans or some other things for the food bank if you're able to. We also have some envelopes available for monetary donations. That's always welcome as well, as we try and fill gaps in the things that we have in the stores. So any gifts will be donated towards the food bank on Saturday. I don't know what time, Lynn? After nine, there will be the chance to come and decorate the church with some flowers, I believe, to celebrate our Harvest Festival. So please do come along if you feel creative and you'd like to do that, whether or not you've done it before. I'm sure the ladies would love a few extra volunteers to come and join in and maybe learn a new skill. So do come along for that. Next Sunday, after the 11 o'clock service, we will be having our community lunch, which obviously will be our harvest lunch as well this time. There is a sign-up list at the back. It will be at 12:30, because obviously we've moved the time forward. So we will be having lunch at 12:30. Next week, and for community lunches going forward, they should always be at 12:30. Tuesday is Women's Fellowship, Wednesday is Coffee Morning, and Monday is House Group. Have I forgotten anything else? One more, thank you.
Sorry, this is advance warning for not next weekend, but the weekend after, Saturday the 23rd of September, still at September, isn't it? It's not October. Many of you know Pamela and Ivor Bartlett. Pamela's just turned 90. Ivor is a bit older. They are celebrating on the 23rd of September their 68th wedding anniversary. You are invited to tea in the church hall. Karen is doing the lion's share of the cooking. So come and enjoy. That's with Ivor and Pamela's love. Come and celebrate with them and their family. That would be wonderful. Thank you very much. 23rd at 3 o'clock. Thank you.
Thank you, Lynn. We're going to stand and sing our final song this morning, Lighthouse. A reminder that wherever we go and whatever we face, that God is with us and he journeys with us. Let's stand and worship God together.
Thank you.
So Jesus, who is with us now and goes with us in the journey ahead, guard, protect, and guide you. May you know his peace and his presence, and his joy and his hope. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and those you love, and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.